So I have a quick question for you all. How many of you are traveling to somebody's house and you're going to be their guest this Christmas season? Anybody? Going out of town? Going close by? Okay. How many of you are having guests in your house? Okay. That's most of us. This is the season for visiting. And one of Christina's families, you know, you get married and you meet a whole other family that you've never been a part of. One of Christina's traditions was that her whole family converges on her aunt's house. And then they stay for a week. It's like 20 people packed into a house, and they don't all get along. So that was pretty exciting. It was kind of like going to the circus a little bit. But as I've thought about that more and more, oh man, what her aunt put up with. Like, that's 20 people to figure out breakfast for and 20 people to do dinner for. And everyone's really helpful, but no one knows their way around the kitchen. So people are just grabbing things. It's sheer chaos. My family tradition was my grandmother would have everybody over for Christmas Eve dinner. And that involved 20-some-odd people. And she started cooking at the as soon as Thanksgiving dinner was over for Christmas Eve dinner. It's crazy. It's a lot of work. It's a big deal when guests come into town or when you host somebody. And yet it's really special. Like, I wouldn't wish it away just because of the work. It's an incredible thing to have people that love you draw near to you. And Advent literally means the arrival. It's the arrival of a guest. Or maybe we're the guest in his house, but it's the arrival nonetheless of a significant guest in our lives. And so we're going to look at, what does it look like for God to arrive in our lives? What is the impact of God showing up? How might we prepare ourselves? And today we're going to look at the start of when God announced his arrival, and that is Luke chapter 1, 26 through 38. And I realized as I kind of settled into this passage that I need to apologize to my small group, because it feels like every time we do small group, we end up talking about a passage, then I'm like, hey, that'd be good to preach on. And so they got to look at this on Tuesday, and we're going to look at it some more. But yeah, let me pray for us. God, we welcome you. We welcome you as our host and as our guest in our lives. Lord, we do ask that you would have impact on us. We ask that we would be open to it and that you would speak to us about where you are, where we are, and what you want to do with our lives. We love you, Lord. Amen. All right. We're going to sit in the birth stories of Jesus for this entire series, so I'm excited about it. But let me read this first part for us. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And the angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Don't be afraid, Mary. You've found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He'll be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I'm a virgin." And the angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you. The power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she who was said to be unable to conceive is now in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail." "I'm the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her. The first thing I want to bring our attention to is that God comes to us in our smallness. I want you to imagine with me just for a moment that the Pope has decided not to celebrate Christmas at the Vatican. He's decided to come to Seattle. And not only that, he decided he really wanted to come to a really incredible church, and so he decided he's going to come to Harvard Church for his Christmas Eve service. Wouldn't that be something? I think we'd be packed out a little bit more. But such a thought is kind of unthinkable. It's actually rather silly because we're so small. We have a great impact and we have a wonderful community of faith, but surely the Pope has somewhere more significant to be on Christmas Eve than our little church. Surely God has somewhere more significant to be than our little lives. And I don't know if you feel particularly worthy of notice or important, but I know that I don't. I live a pretty ordinary life in a very, very big city. There's no particular reason that God should notice me. And yet the crazy thing of this passage I just read is God notices Mary. And it's kind of funny that throughout history we've gone, well, of course he picked Mary. She's humble and she's accepting. There's so many great things about Mary. Of course God would come to her. And we've sort of like moved her up into the saintly realms with the other saints that are not like us. But the thing that the writer is trying to bring our attention to in this passage is that Mary is really ordinary. Even the place. Let me read it again. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee. Galilee's a little, tiny, unimportant part of Israel. Nazareth's a little, tiny town that if you ever get the chance to go to it, go to it. But apart from now it being a tourist attraction, there's really not much to it. It's a tiny, small town. Think like Upper Sandusky, Ohio, sort of. Like smallness. And Mary is a 15-year-old girl who is betrothed to get married to an ordinary carpenter in that town. Nothing particularly significant about that. I was talking to a barista. I get my latte. I like to talk to the barista if I get a chance. And I was just asking her how she was doing, and I could see that she was like, "Rrr." It was a cranky day. She's like, "Well, my car broke down, and so I had to take the bus to work, and I don't even know how much it's going to cost to get it fixed." And my first instinct was to, like, try to fix the problem, but I realized I couldn't. And so I just said, "You know what? I'm going to pray for your car to get repaired quickly and that it won't cost too much." And she said something as I was kind of walking away. She said, "I'm sure God has more important things to do than that." And it struck me that was pretty honest, and that's probably true that much of what we think most of the time about what's going on in our lives is, "Yeah, I guess I could bring it to God, but does God really care? Is he really going to do something about that?" And what this passage tells us is that, yes, God cares. Whatever you have going on in your life is big enough for God to notice, if God noticed Mary. You know, there's this moment when you have guests over. There's always the event. You know, you have the big dinner or you do the thing. But one of the things I love about Harbor is we also have the after party. It's down the hall where people hang out. And there's these moments that happen when you have guests or when you do these hangout times that you all of a sudden enter into each other's lives. And you hear about what's going on. It happens in the small groups. It means a tremendous amount to me. Because when somebody comes into our lives, things have a possibility of changing. There's someone there with us. And whatever you have going on in your life, whatever I have going on in my life, God decided to notice, move in, get close, and care. This season, God wants to be in the midst of your little smallness. Second thing that I want to bring to our attention is that God doesn't just come empty-handed. You know, Christmas Eve service at my grandma's house, everyone would show up. We all brought our presents for everybody else in the family. And so my grandparents were ridiculous gift givers, and the tree was already packed. And then it became like overflowingly packed. And there was a lot of gifts involved in that Christmas. We would eat this 12-course dinner, I think it was, where we were begging to stop at course 8. And then after that was all done and we're like bursting at the seams, then we would sit down and it was important that everyone notice every present. And so we all stopped and each person would open their present and then it would be the next person's turn and we would go in clockwise fashion. And around like 11 p.m., there are children melting down and screaming at the top of their lungs because they can't take it anymore. But we were going to do it this way, and that often ended at like 2 or 3 in the morning. I don't know if it was the best way to enjoy it, but it was something special for sure. I wanna bring to your attention verses 28 and 30 of this passage. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you are highly favored. The Lord's with you." Verse 30, but the angel said to her, "Don't be afraid, Mary. You found favor with God." God shows up with grace and favor. He actually loves us and he wants to extend blessings to us. So often when I think about what would it be like if Jesus were to come over to my house for Christmas dinner, there's like a nervousness that kind of pops up. I would have to have the house like perfect. And then somewhere in the back of my head, I'm like, "Oh, he's gonna look at me and go, man, you did these things right, but oh, Chris, come on, man. I've given you so much and you're still struggling with this. Like, you still worry more about the gifts you're gonna get rather than the ones you're gonna give. This is simple stuff, Chris, come on." It's sort of like a reckoning is what I think of. And this passage says that God shows up and says, "I favor you. I love you." I was watching this show this week. It's The Gifted. I love superheroes. So cheesy Fox show. But there's this moment where this dad is talking to a guy who's about to become a dad. And the guy's asking for advice. And he says this. He goes, "You know, no matter what your kids do, they can't do anything to make you love them any less." And that's how God is with us. There is absolutely nothing going on in our lives, anything that we have done that could make him love us any less. And he shows up with grace and favor, forgiveness, and his love at our door. I was reminded of John 3:16 and 17. "For God so loved the world." We're having communion today, it makes sense. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life." And I'm so sad that gets remembered instead of verse 17 with it all the time, which says he did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. God's favor rests on people. Last piece. It comes with purpose. It comes with possibilities. Read it for us again. I shouldn't have closed my Bible every time. Sorry, you guys get the unfiltered rambling of a pastor. All right. The angel answered, or Mary says, how can this be? And the angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. She who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail." Other translations put it, nothing is impossible with God. What God says happens. Whether it seems likely, whether it seems possible or not. And God definitely has something on his mind. He has a purpose in mind. And what is it that God has in mind for this church? Well, he's obviously watched over it, protected us, brought us here. He's going to do some incredible things this season, this year, in the years to come. What about for our lives? What does God have in mind for that? It's an impossible question. And the beauty of that is that it's bigger than anything that we'd be able to think of. It will surprise us, and it will be blessings that are things we didn't even think could be done. The extent to how God wants to use us in our lives to help his kingdom come into this world, which is so broken sometimes, is much larger than we know. And this story of Mary, the Most High is going to overshadow you. It's going to come inside of you. It's going to grow. And then it's going to start a kingdom that will never end. As Christians, God moved in. The Holy Spirit moved inside of us, begins to do some work in us. The incarnation is not just something that happened 2,000 years ago. It's something that happens every day. As Larry said, our hands and feet are God's hands and feet to do things in the world. That family that Sharon brought to our attention, God's going to move in a very, very tangible way. God is on the move in our world. He's going to take on flesh and bone and presence, and it's about to get real for some people. It's about to get real for us and through us. Whose gift will we be this season? This month, may God surprise you with purposes in your life, with things that he brings about that you didn't know he could. With possibilities that only he can do, and with ways of using you that you might not be able to foresee just yet. So how do we respond? How do we respond to this visitor coming into our midst? This God who invades our lives and brings blessings and favor. I love Mary's response. Okay. May be me as you have said. Let your will be done. Zechariah, earlier in the chapter, Elizabeth's husband gets told that his wife, who's barren, is about to have a kid. And he has lots of questions. Yeah, but we tried. Pregnancy didn't happen. This isn't possible, God. This doesn't work. And Gabriel says to him, no. The Lord says it, so shut your mouth. And actually, he's not able to speak until his son is born. Rough Christmas season, that one, not being able to talk at all. But maybe it's as simple as that. It's may it be to me as you have said. It's meeting with God, asking for his will, and then making ourselves available as much as possible, saying, God, you be my star. You be my shining star in the midst that I'm going to follow. You're the direction I'm going to head. Have your way with me. May his love, his favor, his grace, his purposes permeate your lives this day.